as Krishna was growing up as a child in the house of Nand in Gokul, the maternal uncle Kansa, the king of Mathura, was sending one demon after the other, one asura after the other, to harm one, kill the child. Nand had by now realized that Gokul was no longer safe for the children. His child had been involved in a number of incidents, but his luck had saved him each time. He consulted other cowherds and seniors. Collectively, they decided to shift residence along with their livestock to Vrindavan, a sylvan area not far away and full of old and new trees. Reportedly, its grass was emerald green and there was even a mountain. A variety of herbs and flowering plants grew in Vrindavan. There was an abundance of fruit and vegetables. It was a place of peace and quiet, a place for meditation. Going there might soothe their nerves, made tense by the asuras sent by Kansa. I have included in this video two paintings representing the migrating caravan sitting on the shores of Jamuna to rest, as well as one depicting the life in Vrindavan. Please look at them carefully. You would enjoy them. Look at the intricacy of the drawings and the realism which imbibed the Pahadi paintings. The residents of Gokul loaded their household goods on bullock carts. The large caravan was preceded by hordes of cows, bulls and calves that they considered to be their most precious possessions. While the young, the old and the women travelled in chariots or carts, the cowherds walked behind with sticks to protect their families. They played on turhi drums and blew horns. The purohits accompanying them showered blessings. The most fascinating part of the caravan were the gopis, who had put on fresh, colourful skirts, tight blouses and variegated odhanis. They had applied saffron and sandal paste on their breasts and had put on gold pendants. What a sight it must have been. They sang songs and made merry. Yashoda and Rohini, travelling in the middle of the caravan, were seated in a sumptuously furnished cart. Balaram and Krishna sat by their side and entertained them with their baby talk. Both the boys were inquisitive and asked several questions about trees and flowers and birds that they had come across. Vrindavan was a salubrious forest. It was an abode of peace and ananda despite the changes in the season. When they arrived there, the cowherds arranged their bullock carts in the formation of a half moon. They erected shelters for their animals and covered them with thatched roofs. Vrindavan was a sight for the gods. The islets in the Yamuna, her sandy banks, the Govardhan mountain with shrubs and trees growing green on its sides and on the top, and the evergreen meadows and orchards made it a place ideal for a rural community. For the two lisping brothers, no other place could have been better. Now follows their daily routine for their children, who were growing as cowherds. As the boys grew, they were assigned the duty of grazing the calves. Not the cows, the calves. They were chota. Accompanying other cowherds, Krishna and Balaram carried balls to play with and some food. They made sure that they did not wander far away from the cow stands. Krishna had started playing on a flute. I have included a number of paintings and sculptures with Krishna playing on a flute. The children practiced slingshots, threw balls made of sand to hit targets, and limited the cries of the cattle and ran around helter-skelter as if they were cows and bulls. Yashoda and Rohini used to tie anklets on the legs of Balaram and Krishna to keep a track. Thumping the ground to create a musical beat, both the brothers danced to the delight of their friends. What images they are able to enrapture. Soon the cowboys joined them in their dance and enthralled the audience of friends and passerby with their dexterity. It seemed that dancing came naturally to them. The children learned to distinguish the calls of the peacock, quail, papiha, and several varieties of cuckoos that lived in the dense forest. However, the asuras let loose by Kansa were not far behind. One of them arrived at Vrindavan and, assuming the form of a calf, mingled with the calves being tended by Krishna and Balaram on a pasture. It was a handsome, hefty calf, and Krishna could easily see that it was different from their herd. Reaching it from behind, Krishna caught it by the tail and holding its two hind legs firmly in his hands, repeatedly swung it like a loop in the air, and when it had gathered momentum, threw it against a tree. The asura was killed. Every morning the two brothers got up, had a bath and a light breakfast. Thereafter they left for the grazing fields with their herd. One day Krishna, Balaram and other cowherds guided their thirsty cattle to a pond. The calves had water before Krishna and the cowherds. All of a sudden they noticed a large crane sitting on the bank. He was in fact an asura. His name was Bakosur, who was on a mission to kill children. The crane magically enlarged his sharp beak, caught hold of Krishna and tried to swallow him. Balaram and his companions looked at the crane with fright. Some of them fainted out of fear. In the meantime, as Krishna reached the crane's gullet, he scratched his esophagus and generated enough heat to singe his throat. Bakasur, unable to withstand the fire destroying his throat, vomited the body of Krishna unhurt. He then pounced upon the young boy and tried to kill him, but he was no match for the divine child. Krishna caught hold of the edges of his beak and tore him apart as easily as if tearing a piece of cloth. Looking at the unusual spectacle, the devatas rejoiced in the heavens and celebrated by blowing conches and playing on horns. They beat nagaras, chanted shlokas in praise of the Lord. They showered flowers such as chameli, chandani and parijat. The earthlings could not but rejoice in the heavens. However, they were amazed at Krishna's feet. They took him in their arms one by one and looked at him with admiration and awe. Jai Shri Krishna, Jai Shri Krishna, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.